was born in 1804, right here in New York City. Throughout his life, he was an advocate for education and also the first American consulate general to Japan.
Now, when he took the position as the president of the Board of Education, he proposed creating a free academy where people who couldn't afford going to university was able to obtain a higher education. This establishment of the free building eventually led to the building of this very school.
Over the past century, Townsend Harris High School has produced many influential musicians, some being Mr. Ira Gershwin and Mr. Irvin Drake.
Mr. Ira Gershwin graduated from Townsend Harris in 1914, the same year the first yearbook, the Townsend Harris Annual, later known as the Crimson and Gold, was published. He had been writing songs with his brother George Gershwin for many Broadway shows since the early 1920s.
21 years later, Mr. Irvin Drake graduated from Townsend Harris High School as part of the class of 1935. Having composed many influential songs over the past few decades, Mr. Irvin Drake became president of the American Guild of Authors and Composers in 1973 and kept the position until 1982. In 1983, he was admitted to the Songwriters Hall of Fame.
Many of you might know the song, It Was a Very Good Year, a Frank Sinatra classic. But I bet you didn't know that it was actually composed by Irvin Drake.
Respeechit, atspeechit, prospeechit. Look back, look ahead, look around. Our theme this year is to commemorate the past and to appreciate the present.
Townsend Harris, let us walk down memory lane as we reminisce about the music and images of the past.
When I was 35, drive. When I was 35,
when the school was still known as the Townsend Harris Hall and was fully populated by male students.
In the video, you will find that while many things have changed over the years, one thing certainly hasn't.
The homework load. Yeah, tell me about it.
Well, it's not every day that we get to hear from the earliest graduates. So sit back and enjoy the video.
Next to you were all old comrades.
What made it good was the terrific teachers that we had and the terrific, hard-working students.
A lot of homework. A lot of homework. I remember that. I used to be up all hours. My father never intervened. I guess he knew that it was necessary.
One marvelous teacher I had was James Flynn, an English teacher, and I don't recollect whether I had him for Macbeth or for Hamlet, but he acted out all the parts, even the Ophelia part. So, and that was where I developed a love of English literature.
Talk to me about my German teacher, I guess because of his constant admonition, so you sit, so you work. Sit up, right, and pay attention.
I traveled down from the Bronx by subway. It was an easy ride down to 23rd Street.
In 1940, there was a presidential campaign, and Franklin Delano Roosevelt's own gang came along 23rd Street, and we had the 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th floors of the City College building. And those of us who had a view of the north, windows could look down, and we all rushed to the windows to see the president's motorcade go by.
My late brother had gone to Townsend Harris. He was 3 years ahead of me, and I suppose that's why it wasn't a different thing for me. My brother had gone there, and I always remember him coming in home, I guess, from his first class in French, and saying, "Oh, aujourd'hui, je suis un homme. Today I am a man."
Pierre Courtin, who taught us French, and Mr. Courtin, who was apparently very active in the French community in New York City, taught us a number of popular songs in French, French folk songs, a couple of those were a little on the racy side, that for three young guys.
Because of the age of the students, remember it was a three-year high school. Most of the students were younger than myself when they entered the school. They all had skipped back in those days. You skipped frequently in public school because that was quite the custom. If you were one of the top students, they passed you on, moved you on quickly to the next grade.
If you had skipped a grade or two when you were in grammar school, which also happened to me, I was also short for my age. So being short and so young, I mean, I look like a, I should be wearing short pants instead of going to high school.
I never thought I was going to be lucky enough to get into Townsend Harris. I came from a junior high school, which meant that I did not, when I was admitted to Townsend Harris, I was not admitted as a lower C student, but as an upper C student.
I was one of the expatriates who was thrown out by Mayor LaGuardia when he closed the school in 1942. I was supposed to be in the class of January 44, but the 1 year that I spent here at Harris really formulated my ability to think critically and analytically.
As a result of the students being so hardworking and so competitive, I didn't think I was very good when I was at Townsend Harris. I ended up around the middle of the class. And I thought, well, I'm pretty mediocre. And then I discovered after going to college, Brooklyn College, and going to Harvard for graduate school, that I never worked so hard ever again, even to get a PhD, as I did Harris. I really enjoyed it so much.
What we will be presenting next is a selection from Gershwin's Porgy and Bess.
Porgy and Bess, originally known as Porgy, was actually a novel written by Edwin DuBose Hayward in 1925.
Porgy, a crippled man living in the American slums, has fallen in love with Bess, a beautiful woman. Their feelings for each other blossomed, and they proceed to live together.
Wait, hold on. That's romantic, but isn't that just your everyday typical love story?
Later on, Porgy is arrested and put in jail for convicted murder.
Okay, never mind. That wasn't that typical.
Excuse me, let me talk here. Okay. A narcotics dealer by the name of Sportin' Life takes advantage of the absence of Porgy and proceeds to court Bess, promising the bright lights of New York and a life in the city.
Now, over the years, with the help and musical talent of Ira Gershwin and his brother, George Gershwin, Porgy and Bess have evolved into musicals, movies, and most recently, a Broadway show.
Regardless, well, New York, what do you think of that? The city that never sleeps? Times Square? Or maybe even the Statue of Liberty? Regardless, it's a place of opportunity, hope, a place of grandeur, a place far away from the American ghettos where Porgy and Bess live. Now, New York calls, a place of wealth and fortune, where dreams are fulfilled, where promises are kept, where life is superb, the place of inspiration. I hope that one day, everyone here will be able to find their own New Yorks. Ladies and gentlemen, I am proud to present, there's a vote that's leaving soon for New York.
Turn take.
Come along with me, that's the place. Don't be a fool and come.